to customers, they do their own.
Right, so.
All right, and then you can, you know, they also commit training costs. Right, like we of course come in.
So, just to restart 我们就听不懂英文不太好的没关系，我会做稍微做一下。那这个 PPT 都有那个中文字母啊，就看美剧一样有中文字母。So just to recap, we hear this morning about how we can actually motivate sales people or sales force to outstanding performance, and we just want to have a brief discussion on what are some of the key characteristics of an ideal salesperson. 那如果是一个理想中的一个销售人员，有哪些方面的一些特征特质？ Right. So, anyone would like to share some of your thoughts or experiences? What are some of the key? Yes, Jack.
Okay. I think first of all, this guy should have good presentation skills.
Okay, good presentation skills.
Yes,
right.
And also, I mean, should be outgoing.
Outgoing, okay.
Like, and open-minded.
Right.
And he should, I wouldn't say he should have very good, but he should have some basic analytical skills.
Okay.
And also...
Why is that important, analytical skills?
Because for if you are a salesperson in, let's say, selling some very technical stuff,
right.
You need analytical skills.
Sure.
Unless you sell a bottle of water, I don't think you need analytical skills.
Right.
But if you sell a complicated machine,
right.
I guess
right.
You
okay.
Need.
Okay.
Yeah?
Sure.
And then you shouldn't talk too much.
Okay.
You should be a good listener.
Okay. Good listening skills.
Yeah.
Analytical. Right.
Yes.
Good presentation.
Yeah.
Right.
And he should also be approachable.
Approachable, right.
Easygoing.
Yes.
I think that's all I have.
Being nice to people.
That's
right.
All I have, sort of.
Great, thank you. What about this table? Because I'm going to leave this table last because they got some big data. So I'm going to go to this table first.
And I think we discussed a little bit about the feeling for the right time. So sometimes, of course, if you already have an appointment or so, presentation skills is good. But you know, I always feel this is if I'm called by somebody who wants to sell me something and I'm really busy and he's on and on and on.
Don't talk too much.
Right, so
one of the key things about a good salesperson is to know when to shut up.
Yes.
Okay. Because on the contrary, I also felt, I said, I really don't need your product, but now I agreed to meet you and I don't really know why. And I said, because you're probably a very good salesperson.
Sure. What about here?
I'm going to share some big data with you guys.
Because
we are a talent assessment company, so we recently did a research with all these internet finance companies.
Right. Finance companies, okay.
Internet financial companies. On their the frontier, these employees. And during our data, during our research, that we found the top sales, the one of the most important behavior traits is follow policies.
Oh, okay.
And the second one is client relationship management.
Right. And how do you define that?
Define
client relationship management. Mm-hmm. What is client relationship management?
Yeah.
Oh, it's a very big thing.
Very vague as well.
Yeah, very vague as well.
Yeah.
This is only for internet financial companies.
Yeah, no, I understand. Yes, I understand.
The least on the behavior traits is competitive. But I mean, let's say this is for the financial industry. Like for our HR service industry, we are a small company. We only have 10 employees, including the main people. But last year, we reached 10 million sales revenue.
Wow.
We only have 10 people, including the main one. But we reached 10 million. So everybody, when we join the company, we will have the talent assessment. And we found that all the salespeople in our company, we are all dominated and and influencer.
Right, uh-huh. right, right.
Yes. So we are result oriented and mm. we have good people skills.
Right.
That's it.
Right.
Mm.
Right, great. And every firm wants client relationship management?
So,
we'll come to that later.
We can
no,
share with you.
Later, later, later. Don't worry, don't worry, this is a take
a
time.
You have
a
team of 10 people?
Client relationship management.
表达对他人真诚的需求。
Oh, okay.
Oh,
right, being sincere, caring for customers, thinking from customers' point of view. Great, empathize customers. Right, that's great. Now, and the thing is, actually, it's a trick question. The answer is it actually depends.
Yes.
Right, depends on what kind of industry you are dealing with, what kinds of sales roles you're at. Generally, if you are looking at sales, there are three kinds of sales. Right, there are three kinds of sales. One is what we usually know as business development, or commonly known as hunters. Right, these are people who look for new customers. Right, so they are the one kind. Two is what we call account managers. So these are what we call the farmers. So these are the people who grow existing businesses. Guess what is the third type? The third type is channel salespeople, the people who manage distributors. Right? And all these three kinds of salespeople actually has got three distinctive different skills. So usually, people who are good in one are usually not good in the other two. And vice versa, usually, right? There are different data that supports that. There will also be, the probability is about 20% plus minus, right? There will be people who will be good in everything. About 20% of the time, there will be people who are just good in everything. So 80% of the time, there will be people who will tend to be specializing in one and not the other, right? This is just some ballpark benchmark. So, that's what we meant by characteristics of good salespeople. We'll also look into what are some of the things that motivate salespeople. And this is it. How many of you believe that salespeople are motivated primarily by money? Anyone? You pay more? Well, pay more commission. They work harder. Right. Okay. Yes and no.
Yes and no.
Yes and no. we'll come to that later. Money is one part. We're not saying that it's not important. A lot depends on the kinds of sales cycle you have. Usually, if you have long sales cycle, salespeople are less motivated by money. Because the money comes like 1 year, 2 years, 3 years later, a long time later. So you work a lot, but you don't really see the money coming in until much later. Right, if you're paying by sales commissions and all that, it tends to help if it's nearer. If I do something and then I sell something within a week, a month or so, I see the money there, I'll be more motivated. So which is why, let's just say our industry, the training industry, a lot of people will think that training industry is the same, you just sell courses, right? But if you were to sell corporate training versus business English, it's entirely, totally different. Why? Because business English, the turnaround time is very quick. You get a customer, they want to learn English, they go into business English, usually they sign up within a week. Right? So you see the money coming very quickly. The moment you get a customer, you will usually close the customer within a week or two. Right? Or the customers decide not to buy from someone else. So you get a result, positive or negative, within a week, couple of weeks, maximum a month. Right, that's business English. But if you have corporate training like ours, sometimes we can close within a week. But those are very, very rare. Some other times we can close within 3 years. Right? So it really depends. And then usually it takes months to discuss, to customize. We have customers who like us, but they don't have current needs. And we need to wait for the right cycle at the right time, which we don't know when it's going to happen. Right? So these are some of the different sales cycle, and it takes a lot of time, energy, and effort and resources to actually follow through without being paid, because customers aren't paying. So it really depends. Okay, so money is a motivator, we're not denying that. But it may not be the only motivator, it may not be the key motivator as well. It really depends. So if you are talking about complex machinery, if you're talking about complex complex equipment, now the thing about buying equipment is this, 如果是卖设备的话, right, equipment sales or solution, technical sales, 就有带方案的那种, 的技术项目, right, solution technical sales, usually the sales cycle is about 3 years. Why? Because it's, if the customer bought something, they usually have got a new production line, a new plant, a new something. Huge investments in overall. Right? The next time they are going to buy something else, usually it's about 3 years later. 3 to 5 years later. Then they will make, and that's assuming the customer is actually growing, the business is getting better, or that they got old plants, old equipment they need to replace. So that's the assumption. So usually that cycle is about 3 to 5 years. So if you see the customer at the wrong time, right, they just invested in something, wait 3 years. it's just a fact of life, it's tough. Yeah. Some companies are smart because besides selling equipment, because they only have three persons, you're the fourth one, just San Chui. Right. And this is yours, by the way.
Thank you.
Right. Do you have food?
No, I'm okay.
Okay, because this.
No, that's
yours, okay. It's yours. The food on the table is yours. So, sorry. Right, so I was. Yes, I was saying that if you are smart enough as an equipment manufacturer, some people are smart. They actually sell parts in addition to equipment, and they sell parts that are also usable on other people's equipment. Right. So some are smarter, so that they can actually sell something first while waiting for the cycle to come. Right. Some other equipment manufacturers, especially if you are German. Usually the parts can only fit into your own equipment.
Oh.
So you suck.
Once you're in,
you're out. So it's really, I mean, they're usually the Americans, sometimes the Japanese, usually are smarter. They have equipment that can fit into other people's equipment. They got parts that can fit into other people's equipment, and usually that will help the sales person to sell bit by bit into that account, and hopefully 3 years later they want to buy the whole thing. Right? So it really depends. So that's motivating sales people besides money. And how do you make the sales team focused and motivated? Okay, so next thing is on rare requirements of your ideal salesperson, and we have this little quiz. This is something that we do usually for typical some skill strength. So you got salesperson A, very humble, salesperson A, 很谦卑, right? Full compliance to his customer's whims and fancies, 就对客户千百顺为命是从, and always diligent when working for his customers, 对为客户做事从不怠慢, that's A, right? And salesperson B, very confident, 非常自信, give guidance through a way of thinking of his customers, 引导客户的思维方式, only do meaningful things for his customers and refuse anything that does not bring benefits, 只为客户做有益的事情而不干那些效益低较低的活, right? By the way, you don't have to take every picture of the slide, because we will have a QR code later which you can scan and you can download all the slides. For a while, I thought you were taking pictures of me. for this, and how many of you believe that? How many believe that A will be more successful? Right, A may be more. They will both be successful, but how many believe that A will be more successful? How many believe B will be more successful? B will be more successful. Okay, why? Why A?
I think it's
similar to the thing you were saying, so you're selling the parts first.
Sure.
So sometimes you can sell something even though it doesn't bring very high benefits, like
right.
the profit rate is not very high.
Sure.
But for the company, the client, it can be very meaningful.
Sure.
So they can see what you actually can do.
Right.
And then later,
right.
the cycle will be full and you can
right.
do something with it.
Right, right, okay, okay. So you can be nice customers and you'll be more, you gain the trust and what do you call the trust and support from a customer, right? Why B? Those who mentioned, yes, why B?
B quite makes a clear point of being very confident.
Right.
But
why is that important?
Well, if a salesman comes to me and is not confident, doesn't believe in what he's selling, I won't buy.
Yes. If I'm selling this bowl of water and I'm not confident that, I don't know, is it good, is it healthy, will it die? Yeah, so better than buying, right? I mean, the salesperson needs to be confident about what he's selling or is the company behind him. What else? Yes, Stephanie.
I think what always kind of persuades me is if what's written there, refuse to do anything that does not bring benefits. So if somebody
right.
tells me he can do everything,
right.
I don't believe from the
right,
company.
Right. And why is this important?
It's trustworthy.
What do you think is the most important resource a salesperson can have? Time. Why?
Yes.
Why? Time?
Because if you
have
time, then time is money.
Time is money, yes. No, time is more important than money. why? It's why it's right? Why time? Time is the most important resource. Number one, you have limited time because every one of us has got 24 hours. We won't be able to get more time. Even if you want to work overtime, your customers may not want to see you, even if you want to work harder, right? Number three, in terms of customer-facing time, right? Your face-to-face time with customers is about 20 to 30% of your overall working time. You are only able to see your customers face to face about 20 to 30% of the time. 平均只有百分之十到三十时间能够跟客户面对面，就面对面见面。What happens to the rest of the 70 to 80% of the time? Preparation for the customers, what else?
Yeah.
Follow up afterwards.
Okay, follow up, what else? The biggest one? Traveling.
Yes.
You are stuck in a traffic jam somewhere.
Yeah.
So that's the biggest portion of time. So if you are not careful about what you can do for what kinds of customers, you may be actually wasting a lot of time, or you are spending the wrong time on the wrong type of customers for the wrong purpose. Right. So that's one of the key things. Now, and of course, we talk about time, it's also relating to timing.
Yeah.
Timing means, just now we talked about the equipment, if you're going the right timing, great. The Chinese saying is, 吃三年. You're going the right timing, okay, the customer wants to have new equipment, new everything, so your sales targets are met for the next 3 years, right? You go in for on the wrong timing, you wait for 3 years. So that is time and timing. So that's important. Now, what will be some of the weaknesses that salesperson B might have? Actually, yes.
One of the weaknesses I have,
yep.
I've seen with salesperson B, especially with the point three.
Yes.
Only do meaningful things for
yes.
his customers and refuse anything that does not bring benefits.
Right.
If I were the customer,
yes.
If I ask you to do something,
yeah.
you refuse,
yes.
because I know these are the things that will not bring benefits to
right.
your company and you refuse.
Yeah.
Actually, when you try to sell something,
right.
I don't like you.
Right, right. So you
so
may alienate customers.
That's why sometimes,
mm-hmm.
even if it does not bring benefits to your
right.
company, but you believe this will, let's say, establish a good,
right.
know, let's say, good,
if this is
relationship,
a qualified
you
customer.
Have to do it.
Right. So if this is a qualified customer, the key thing is whether the customer is qualified or not. Is Stephanie going to say something?
Yeah, I think it depends very much
yes.
on what you're selling, actually.
Yes.
Mm.
Because, I mean, from our industry, we know that you do the Stripe systems, and
yes.
sometimes the customer's technical knowledge simply is on a different level, and they might want something, so they copied a machine. They have no clue what is in the machine. So we say, yes, we do everything like you want it and like you plan it. It probably breaks down before it starts running. So,
some customers don't really know what they want. Right. So we always have customers who don't really know what they want. And the worst customers are not those that do not know what they want. Those who do not know what they want, but pretend they know. That's what we want to avoid. So over here, salesperson B, what we want to know is, in terms of, if you look at it objectively, this is great, because this guy is confident, can guide customers, is able to manage time and resources well, so that should be better. But if he's not careful, he may come across as someone who is a bit arrogant, a bit more, what I call, a bit more unapproachable. So that's B, right? A, although, what's the problem with A?
Customer service.
It is like customer service. Okay. What else? What's the main issue with A?
If that guy faces a customer who's very dominant, he will have problem managing the customer.
Yes, A has got issues managing the customer's expectations. So there is an issue when you're overly nice to customers may feel that the customer. Or you need the customer much more than the customer needs you, mm-hmm. Right? So if you have a situation when the customer, whether it's real or not, we don't know, but if the customer feels that you need him much more than he needs you, then what happens is in terms of negotiations, in terms of bargaining power, the customer will feel that they will have a much higher bargaining power and as a result be more dominant. Right, so that's the impression that A may give to the customer. Right, but there are also good things about A in the sense that we want to be confident, but we don't want to be confident to the point of being arrogant. Mm-hmm. So there's a point of being a little bit humble while being confident. Right? In Chinese, it's called 不卑不亢. Right? So we're nice, we're confident about what we do, but we don't want to be overly standoffish with the customer. Right? What we did is we actually did this is not a study, this is an assessment on the job. So this varies depending on different companies, on different sales role. So this is only a profile of a certain company. Right? It doesn't apply to other people, it just applies to a certain role in a company, in a specific company. So we have this assessment for the job. So this job is someone who requires someone who can exploratory skills, which means go around and meet people, find leads, find opportunities. The best candidate is one who gets out and about, meets others, opens up new opportunities and possibilities. The job demands someone who possesses strong driving qualities. So it's very similar to what Lulu mentioned about her own company, someone who is more outgoing, more extroverted, has drive, assertive on goals and all that. Right, luckily candidate will have the strength of character to overcome opposition and self-confidence to get around obstacles and rules that stand in real progress. Sorry, this is based on the UK assessments, but the English is very British, so please bear with us. This specification underlines the need for a high achiever. The work entails a fair degree of attention to detail, accuracy, and quality control. Now, before this line, everything before that is go out there, meet people, drive the sales. But there's also a quality that what Jack has mentioned. If it requires a bit of technical information, then maybe you also need to have some buts of being attention to detail, accuracy, and quality control. Right? So it's also in balance. In this job, persuasiveness is likely to prove a valuable quality, so you need to persuade others to buy in. Right? So this are some qualities, some over here. In this job, you have been cast in an entrepreneurial role. You should therefore be searching for every opportunity that presents itself. So again, find opportunities. Once you have found an opening that's worthwhile, you must be willing to expend energy to make it happen. So you need to find opportunities and grab opportunities and materialize opportunities. The job has strong social dimensions attached to it, and the way in which you are seen by others will be important. So if you are in DISC, then it's more I than D in this role. And a bit of C as well. So more of a compliant thing, more of a social thing, more of an exploratory, outgoing thing. Right? You will need to stand on your feet and take personal responsibility in this job. So this is not in whichever dimension, it's more of a value. Are you able to have that mentality to take personal responsibility? Because if you are out there in the field, if you're out there in facing customers, are you able to make decisions without conferring back to headquarters? And you need to make the decisions that you know will be approved and supported by headquarters. Okay, so that's you need to stand on your feet. It will be important for you to make your own decisions on without relying on others. Okay, so this is some of the things again. We'll be sending you after this morning. So some of the key qualities: willing to adapt. Are you able to adapt to different situations? Right? Are you enterprising, as in finding new opportunities and materializing that stuff? Reliant, competitive. Are you able to want to achieve more and seize this opportunity? So these are key qualities. And some of the things that does not make that salesperson great. So if you're inflexible, it's no good. If you're indecisive, it's no good. If you are frightened of failure, it's no good. What am I frightened of failure? How many of us here has got a technical background? To me, you know, 技术背景, right? What is the difference between a salesperson and a technical person? Or what's the difference between a sales job and a technical job? 销售活跟那个技术活有什么主要的一些区别？ Now,
things they care about is different.
The things they care about, what things?
One is people, one is another.
Okay, what is customers? Is people, yeah. Okay, that's one part. What else? Now, if you look at success rates, 成功概率, if you're in a technical job, technical role, or technical task, what is the definition of success? What is your accuracy rate? 你的准确率要达到多少？如果是技术活。 Well, you can't do 100%, but in Six Sigma, it's 99.999, right? Or 99.99, depends on how I look at it. So that is the accuracy rate for technical work. In sales job, if I give you 100 new customers, and I give you a period of 3 years, out of that 100 new customers with a period of 3 years, how many of them do you think you can close at the end of 3 years? 给你足够销售资源，给你足够的这个时间，给你买个新客户， 你觉得在3年以后你能够成交多少个？ Big guess. Good. 100 new customers. We can even assume that they're all qualified. And three-year time period. So there's no issue about meeting the right cycle. Right? So out of the 100 new customers, 3 years period, how many of that do you think a typical salesperson can close at the end of 3 years?
I think 20-30% would be good enough.
It's about 20-30%. At around 30%, you'll be a top sales.
Yes.
Right. So that said, if you achieve 50%, either the number of customers are really small. It's a very niche business. It's either the customer buy from you or buy from a competitor. There are no other choices, and the customer must buy. Right, so it's either that, or you really are a legend. So what? Right, because 50% means every two customers you close one, right, eventually. Right, so that is how usually in most industries about 30% will be top sales. In some industries, in some roles where you basically only have key accounts, the closing rate is actually about 5-10%. Because not because you can't close, but because you don't have time to manage that many different customers. Right? So those are some of the issues. So what I'm getting at is, even at 30% success rate, what is your failure rate? 70%. Right? A typical top sales will fail 70% of the time, right? And it may not be the fault of the salesperson. It could be this is the wrong customer, customer doesn't have the need, the customer doesn't have the budget, and etc. It could be some external factors. It's not because of you. Or it could be you don't have the right products for the right customers. So by frightened of failure, over here is if you're in sales, you need to be not frightened of failure. You need to go into a sales meeting understanding that, no, if I meet this customer, there is a high chance that due to some other reasons, customers may not buy. But I'm going to try anyway. So that's the difference between sales and technical. Technical will want to reduce failure to almost zero. Will want to only do something if you are really, really almost 100% sure of success. Then you do something. That's technical thinking. In sales, sales thinking is, let's just do something. And then see what happens. If it happens well, then we continue. If it doesn't happen well, then we stop and go to some other customers, right? So it's more a trial and error, okay? So you need to also be more adventurous. So unadventurous is a bad thing. So these are some things that we can see for that particular role. Is it helpful or not helpful, right? So that it really depends. Now, most of all, what really matters in terms of good or bad sales is really the attitude. Right. If you're looking at anything that's really common across different industries, across different sales roles, whether you are the hunter, the farmer, or the channel salesperson, the thing that really, really matters is attitude. And there are two kinds of attitude. Right? One is positive, and one is negative. So how do you define positive attitude? What are some of the key traits of positive attitude? So we have this. Positive attitude is what we call When you have a problem, do you find a way to solve it? We're not saying that you can solve every problem, but you find ways, or you try to find ways to solve problems. 遇到问题，我们会想办法来解决问题，不一定能够完全解决，但是会想办法去解决。If you are problem bringers, 不一定是问题制造者，是问题带来者。 But problem bringers, basically what they say is, boss, I have a problem, can you solve it? 老板，我遇到问题，你来解决。Right, so that's problem bringer. You only spot the problems. You don't think about ways how we tackle the issue. Right. Again, we're not saying that good attitude means you can solve every problem, but it's a matter of are you willing to face and find ways to solve a problem? Maybe not the entire problem, but part of a problem. Right. So these are two main attitudes. So typically, if you are we mentioned earlier on, when you face with opposition, in sales, you always get rejections. You always get people who don't understand your products, who don't see the value. How do you then find a way or different ways to overcome that? 你就在做销售的时候，可能客户不喜欢你的产品，不喜欢你品牌，问你是什么国家生产，不喜欢，不了解你的产品，不认同你能带来这个价值。 Right, so as a salesperson, 你会有怎样的一些方式来就是让客户了解？ Right, sometimes even after you try different angles, you still fail, and that's a fact of life. Right. But the thing is, do you actually try different angles? So that's the attitude that we are looking at. Okay, so this is something we are looking for, people with good attitude. From the customer's aspect, this is another study. We have the source is called very small. It's a company called HR Charlie. It's a sales competency company based in the US. And what they did is they did this study for about 12, 15 years or so and interviewed about 80,000 different customers, not salespeople, customers worldwide. And these are some of the things that customer responded as in what they expect from salespeople. So customers want salespeople to be personally accountable for customers' results. 就要为就是你卖的东西的结果完全负责. What do I mean by that? Now, if you have customers, and customers for some reason, maybe your delivery is late, maybe there are some product defects, maybe they operated on your equipment and it didn't work, do they call your customer hotline or do they call the salesperson's mobile phone? They will always call the salesperson's mobile phone, right? Why is that so? You have a customer service hotline, it's toll free, it's 40800. Why don't they call that? Why do they call the salesperson? Why?
Because you are the first contact.
Well, you're first contact. You are a person that convinced the customer to buy from you. Right? So the customer will I mean, if you're a customer yourself, you will also call the salesperson, right? Chinese 就是说，你那个什么是你护了客户，让客户帮你买，是因此你要为客户完而全权负责。 Right, so that's what customers expect salespeople to do. Anything wrong, I'll hold the salesperson accountable, even though I know that something that went wrong is not the salesperson's fault. But I'll hold the salesperson accountable to help me solve it. Right, work internally or whatever. Right, so that's customers' expectations. They expect the salesperson to understand customers' business. Especially if you're selling technical products, if you're selling anything that is a solution, customers will like to know, okay, how does your solution fit into my company? What kinds of problems or challenges do you solve for me or overcome for me? So these are some of the things that customers are more keen on. So if you don't understand the customer's business, the customers don't really want to talk to you. So which is why it's more and more important to let salesperson know what is business acumen. How do you help the customer to either increase sales, not for you, but for the customer, or reduce costs for the customer, or improve productivity for the customer? These are some of the key areas the customers expect salespeople, right? Customers expect salespeople to proactively give advice. Now, it also depends on certain kinds of customers. Some customers, just want to mention, some customers don't know anything. And if they tell you they don't know, that's great. The problem is there are some customers who don't know anything, but is very afraid that someone else know that they don't know. Right? So that kind of customers usually know. They don't want you to give advice because that means they don't know. Right? Most of the time, customers, whether they know or don't know, if they are a little bit more confident about themselves, whether they know or don't know, really will appreciate if a salesperson can actually proactively advise, you know, which is the best equipment, how is the best usage, when is the best time to buy, etc. It could be dealing with business results, it could be, you know, if you deal with imported products, when will be a good time because the exchange rate looks nice. Right? And so on. Other issues, or if there's going to be an upcoming promotion or upcoming technical person from Germany who's coming over and visit some key customers and so on. So do the salesperson proactively give advice to the customer without the customer asking? Right? So this is something that's much appreciated. Suggest the right solutions that solve customers' problems. Customers generally don't want to buy something that they cannot use. Right? They want to buy something that will provide a solution. They want you to be easily accessible. So usually when we do sales training, it is a huge challenge because the salesperson will always have a lot of phone calls. Right? And we need to manage that by saying, can you return the phone calls through the breaks, or put a silo in, unless the customer says that they don't receive your products, and when they don't receive your products, they're going to have downtime, and when they have downtime, you need to pay them millions of dollars. Yes, please return that call. Or the customer is a key customer, and they are going to buy a lot of things from you. But we need to manage that. But generally speaking, customers expect sales people to be accessible like 24 hours a day, 7 days a week. Unless you go to North Korea, then you are completely uncontactable. Right? So that's one side. But most of the time, customers will expect you to be accessible, right? So if you don't return, if you cannot pick up the call due to whatever reason, you're on a plane, you're driving, and so on, they expect you to return the call within a day, right? So that's the expectation. You need to be creative in responding to customers' needs, and there are various things about being creative. One is customers more and more would like to have customized solutions, not standardized solutions. It's a trend. It began in China. It's now a global trend. Two is that creative can also be this. Now, what will be the key difference between a good sales and a great sales? Okay, this is based on some of the studies again. 就好的销售跟卓越的销售有什么区别? they're both good, right? So what are things that separates the good and the really great? Any suggestions?
Creativity.
Creativity in what way?
Make the solution more, exceed the needs.
Okay, make the solution more towards the customer's needs is one thing. What else? How do you make the solutions be more attractive to customers? Can the salesperson do it alone? You see, the salesperson doesn't really work alone. The salesperson, if you want to give any creative solution, customized solution to the customer, the salesperson needs to work with internal departments. Right, so the difference, and this is not for me, this, there's some other research that mentioned that. The key difference between a good sales and a great sales is, in terms of selling skills, they're about the same. The key difference is that the great sales can handle external customers, they can also handle internal departments. Right, the more you work with internal departments to find something creative and more customized and better, and if a customer needs an urgent order, you can somehow work with supply chain, production, and so on, and find a solution that they are happy and customers get what they need. That becomes a great salesperson. Right? And it's not easy. You probably don't do that with every single customer. But if you are able to do that for some key customers, not just handling external customers, but also tackling internal departments, that is what makes great salespeople. So that's where this is pointing towards. Right, so these are some of key things. Some other main ways of salespeople, they always ask questions. I think we know about that. The key thing is how you ask the question. So this is a study from a company called Spin Selling, or this methodology called Spin Selling. So the people who ask questions tend to be stronger in getting better results. They're personally accountable, we mentioned that earlier. They reach out to all people who can influence the outcome of the sale. They don't just sell to one person. They reach out to multiple people who might have influence on the sale. Right? Because a lot of times, the decision to buy or not to buy may not be just one person's decision. Right? So you need to reach out to more. They create value by providing advice and insights to customers, we mentioned that earlier. They ask questions regarding... So these are some of the key things in that additional that decides what is a good and great sales. Some of the key things that customers may want. Anyone who is a salesperson here? What's helpful? Okay, this is very good news. Because this is again HR Charlie, the company mentioned earlier. They did the same study, they do multiple choice, and they sent to the customer and said, how did you choose which supplier to buy from? This is one question, it's multiple choice. So there are things about product quality, pricing, brand, service, and so on. So there's a long list, and of course, salesperson. So 39% of a respondent take salesperson. Now, if you were to think about this way, if you sell a product, and your competitors are around in the same kind of positioning, same kind of branding, same kind of technical capabilities, right? Same roughly similar kinds of features and benefits. Even the price, there could be some difference in price, but it's going to be similar price range. Everything is going to be similar. The only different thing that's totally different is a salesperson. Right, so that's why. So this figure in China may actually go up. This is a global figure, so we don't know about China, but in China, it may be higher. No, it won't be 90. Maybe 40%+, maybe 50%, but it's going to be, wait, right? Some things to avoid. Over-promise and under-deliver. What do you mean by over-promise and under-deliver? Sometimes salespeople will do this. Whatever the customer wants, they say yes. Can you deliver tomorrow? Yes. Can you provide free delivery? Yes. Can you install for free? Yes. Free training? Yes. Everything, yes. So eventually everything becomes no, and the customer gets pissed off and they don't buy anymore. So this is bad. This is about time. Those with bold usually are the key things. They don't qualify and prioritize. So, wrong spelling. They don't look into what is the real customer that you need to spend more time on, right? So we mentioned that as a salesperson, your time is limited. Your time has got a constraint. So you can only spend time or more time on the more qualified customers. So this is important. You put a sales target in the first place rather than a customer's interest. Now, we talk about asking questions. Asking questions is very important in sales, but it also depends on what kinds of questions you ask. Some salespeople, on the first meeting, they sit down, exchange name cards, and the first questions they ask is, so, do you buy this product? How much do you buy in a year? When do you need it? What is the price you want? Right, so apart from the first question, which is a closed question, the other three are actually open questions. And a lot of sales traders say you need to ask open questions, right? As in, when do you buy? How much quantities do you need? Right, what is the price you usually buy? These are open-ended questions. You start with the 5 W's and 1 H, right? But if you were to ask this few questions on the first meeting, what's going to happen? When are you buying? How much do you want? What is the price you want? And this is the first three questions coming out of your mouth as a salesperson on the first meeting with that customer. What's going to happen? Customer is going to be very, very pissed. Why? And we're not saying that these questions are not important. They're important at the end of the sale. Right? But if you were to ask at the very beginning of the sale, the customer is going to be very pissed because you are focusing on what?
Yourself.
On yourself, on your sales targets, when you want to buy, when can I give it to you, right? So the customers will be, the customer is going to feel that, firstly, you're not focused on my needs. Number two, I've not even seen your products. I don't even know what you can do, and now you're asking me when I'm going to buy. Right? So the customers get very, very pissed if you were to do that. They sell at price all the time. Again, if your only sales tool is, oh, this is what you want. Okay. If you sell on price all the time, then what happens is that that's just so much price you can go down. And guess what else? There'll always be a competitor who can sell at a low price. If you want this, I give you a good price. I give you a good price, right? Just like what we buy the, we mentioned earlier, Xiangyanglu, Kejiguan. I give you good price, give good price. And then the guy next door says, I give you better price. So there's no end to lower price. Price is, in a way, you can use it to your advantage, but you don't sell on price all the time. We're not saying that you cannot reduce price. You can, but that should be part of everything else. Right, they sell through frequency all the time, it's bad as well. Right? Because there's some part of it is through relationships, there's some part of it is through what is the solution, what is the advice you can give a customer. They leverage on a single customer contact within the customer's organization. You mentioned that if that person were to leave, then you don't have any more contacts. Right? That person, usually if the customer tells you, no, just talk to me, I will make all decisions. Don't talk to anybody else. What does that mean? Usually that means the person is not the decision maker. Usually customers, if they are decision makers, they usually tell you, I'm not decision maker. I only gather inputs. But that person is very likely to be decision maker. Anyone that says, I'm decision maker, give me everything, don't talk to anybody else. Usually that person is not a decision maker. When you give that person something, the person will say, oh, I've actually submitted to approval. So if you're a decision maker, you don't need the shampi. Right? So usually people will say they are decision maker, they are not. So you don't just leverage on a single contact. Right? And of course, they lie to your customers. So these are some things that are bad, and you want to see what are some key traits of good sales people. So how do you motivate salespeople besides money? Next is we know basically what are shapes and forms of salespeople. What else? Now, are salespeople, you can put the word sales in front. Are salespeople motivated only by money? Yes? No?
No, we have big data.
Yes. Right, so if not, what else? If not just money, and again, we're not saying money is not a motivator. Money is a motivator. The key is only. Right, so if not only, what else? So, if you look at the word motivation, it's actually based on two English words, motive and action. So you put them together, that's motivation. So you have a motive to do something, and then you take action, right? So if you were to look at motive itself, what is motive? It's actually a simple or complex net formula. Motive is you have the chances of success. If I do something, if I do A, can I succeed? And if I were to succeed, what do I get? Right? And divided by how much of effort do I need to do A to succeed? Right? So this basically, if you are looking at in sales or other kinds of work-related items, these are some of the things that tend to influence the sales or the action part of motivation. So let's look at it one at a time. Now, if you want to motivate salespeople, sometimes the best way to motivate is training. Why? You don't motivate, but it's sales or, for that matter, any position. You want to motivate an employee, sometimes the best way is training and coaching or mentoring or somehow of upskilling. 就让如果你要激励任何人任何的员工有时候最好方式就是让他们的能力提升 Why?
There will be less effort to do for the same
thing. This is the first one. My chances of success go up. If I know, if I'm in sales, right? Let's just use sales as an example. If day in, day out, I'm facing a lot of tough and difficult customers with funny requests, and we don't know how to handle that. So every day I get rejection. I don't even get 70% rejection, I get like more than 90% rejection. What will happen to that salesperson? What will happen to their morale? It's like, I'm a failure, I can't do this, right? So that chances of success is very, very small. It's less than 10%, it's even less than 5%. It's good. They are not going to put a lot of effort because they don't see how they can succeed. Then if you have some training, some mentoring, some coaching, on how do you handle that difficult and demanding customers? They see this going up. Immediately they feel motivated. And it's got nothing to do with money. The money can only materialize if money is part of this. This can only be materialized if they see, if they put in effort, they can succeed. The other thing is also the time, as in the sales cycle. Why are we saying that if you put this as money, but your sales cycle is very long, for 1 year, 2 year, 3 year sales cycle? It's not because you don't see your chances of success, but you see your chances of success as very far away. So yes, I will succeed, but it's going to be like 1-2 years later minimum. So I'm not as motivated by the money 1 or 2 years later. I need something over here that can give me quick returns. Right? So over here, besides money, what else can we give? 除了钱，我们能给什么呢？ 预期回报。 Acknowledgement, encouragement, yes. Promotion. Okay, the thing about promotion. Is it a good idea to promote salespeople to be managers? 销售人员如果要擢升成经理，好事还是坏事？坏事。为什么是坏事？
A good sales may not be a good management.
Yeah.
Okay.
What is the percentage of? What is the percentage of good sales becoming good managers? Same thing, it's a research by HR Charlie. Give a guess. 好的销售能够顺利成为好的经理的概率大概是多少?
I've only met one in my whole life.
Okay. The official research, it's about 15%, 1.5. Okay, so we're not saying the rest of 85% are hopeless. Maybe they are not prepared, they don't go for training and so on, but Just based on research, just on random, about 15% of great salespeople or top salespeople can become good managers. So if you want to promote them, it may or may not be a good idea. And what we found is sometimes sales managers, when they are newly promoted, they regret it. 就有些刚主播生成为销售经理的那些人，有时候是后悔的。 Why? They found that they got more work and less pay. Right? Because in the past, they just need to take care of themselves. They get a lot of sales bonuses, they got a lot of the monetary rewards on their own. Now they have to manage a new team. And for a new team, they're all new, fresh, inexperienced salespeople.
That means the company should be blamed because the company has a wrong remuneration package.
Well, it's not about wrong, it's because theoretically, objectively,
no,
the sales manager is supposed to get bonus from the team. The salesperson get bonus from individual effort. Right? So if you're a manager, so you get sales bonus from the team. So in theory, it works well because you have a package and then you get bonus from the whole team, so you should actually make more money. But what is not taken into consideration is that if you have a new team, newly hired team, you need to train them, coach them, which is a lot of work. Their results will not be seen until 1, 2, 3 years down the road. Halfway between that, there will be people leaving the job and there will be new people joining. So you need to restart the whole process of training, coaching all over again. So for the first 3 years of a new sales manager, it's going to be very tough. And if you don't like coaching people and developing people, you find that you regret being a sales manager. Right? If you like the job, if you like coaching people and find that you want to grow in your career and be higher into management, that's okay. It's a trade-off. It's a sacrifice you know you need to make. But on the other hand, sometimes salespeople are just thinking about, okay, what's the next step, sales manager? They go in without understanding that this is one job that is not as easy. You may end up doing more and getting less. Right? If they are aware, it's fine. But a lot of times, they are not aware. So that's a thing. So you may not be able to give promotion, but you can actually give encouragement, 鼓励, recognition if they did something well, if they meet certain call requirements, 拜访次数的一个概率，或者说一个次数达到一定的这个标准, right? So if they do that, then you may have some interim rewards, can be certain gifts, can be something that doesn't cost a lot of money, but some form of encouragement to them. Sometimes it's also how you make it known to the rest of the team. 你有没有就是当众的就是给予肯定，给予表扬？ So sometimes start before we hit the payload, before the customer buy, on along the way, they did all the right things. We visit the right customers, they qualify the right customers, they really know what needs they have, they really know how to follow that sale. It's a matter of time that they net something, and they're on the way. So on the way, we may want them to give some little things. It can be just words, it can be something that is small and cost little, but something to just let them know that they're getting some payoff along the way, right? So this is true, it need not always be money. And the third one, this is also linked to, just want to mention about training. It also links to support. Are the internal departments supportive of the salesperson? Do we have a good working relationship? Usually salespeople tend to fight with, or the sales department tend to fight with everybody. Why is that so? 虽然我们好像跟所有部门都树立为敌，都在打。 Why?
They get pressure.
Actually, they get customers' requests. They get customers' requirements. They need to go back and work with different departments. And then some departments, it really depends also on the corporate culture, company culture. Some departments are not really wanting to, some departments are more inflexible than others. Some departments don't really want to cater to salespeople's needs, requirements. Some other times, it's also salesperson do not know how to communicate.